Coach, it's time for one more seminar. We welcome all of you. Let me share my screen. Rini, can you see the screen, please?
Thank you.
So once again, welcome everybody, and I request all of the participants to please keep the microphone on mute. That will help all of us. Welcome to yet another webinar on by the Bento Coach. Here are a few cooperation that we expect from people. Please keep your mic on mute. And whenever you have questions, please type in your chat box and we will see how many of them we can answer. And we will be on time. We'll try to close by 8 p.m. today. A small story about Bento Coach. When we think about coaches, we normally associate coach with a sports team where decisions are made by the coach. And the team is told how to play, what else to be done. The strategy is made by the coach. In recent years, however, this definition has expanded to include various other areas, including career, executive coaching, and relationship coaches. So a coach is someone who helps you achieve the goals that you want to achieve, you set out for yourself. And we help you find the answers by asking questions and facilitating reflections. And that is how the idea of Bento Coach was born. We took inspiration from the Japanese concept of bento boxes. Bento is a single portion, like a takeout or homemade, home-packed meal. The term bento literally means convenience. And that's when where it was like a convenient way to carry a meal. This is the approach that we want to apply to coaching. We want to make coaching accessible and convenient for everyone. And at Bento Coach, we believe that coaching works. Our job as a coach is to help you assimilate complex ideas and processes by breaking them down into bite-sized nudges and insights. And we believe that, you know, learning and therefore coaching is a continuous process. As a result, our bespoke programs are long-term by design. While we do provide short-term interventions, but our clients gain the utmost by engaging themselves for a long-term intervention. And finally, we believe that coaching should be available for everyone who wishes to grow, and coaching can benefit everyone willing to make that change. So this is our team. Three of us. Anjani is our founder. She's a school hotel school graduate with a passion for human resources. She has 20 plus years of experience in hospitality, retail, financial services, market intelligence, oil and gas industries. She has done extensive work in operations and support teams and at various leadership positions. She has been HR head for lead for four mergers and acquisitions. She has mostly worked outside of India. Her most recent role was Group HR Director for Uni Group based out of Dubai. Anjani has designed three proprietary trainings for senior management. And as a coach, she has over 15,000 hours of coaching experience, which includes mostly CXO levels across multiple sectors and industries. And myself, Vimal, I am basically a chemical engineer. Having almost 30 years of experience, worked for multinationals like ICI, PepsiCo, and Profetti, although I started off as a scientist with DRDO. That's been my story. And today's speaker is Prashant. Prashant has almost 25 years of experience. And when I look at Prashant, I actually feel like, you know, there's a medicine standing in front of me. Because Prashant has been a pharma man. You know, you name any pharmaceutical industry that comes to your top of your mind, and Prashant has got there. So he has 25 years of experience, and all of it is in pharma. Prashant, if I'm not wrong. and he has worked in marketing, in sales. And the biggest news for me was when I heard about Prashant that he is a postgraduate in marketing, but he's also a microbiologist. Is that correct, Prashant?
Yep.
So Prashant is a microbiologist, okay? And he's worked for companies like Cipla, like Ranbaxy, like, you know, Alembic. The list goes on and on and on. So that's how Prashant is as far as his professional career is concerned. He's also a visiting faculty for NMIMS Mumbai in the management school. He has 3 international coaching certificates, one from the ICF, one from Marshall Goldsmith, and the other one is from Global Coach Group. So he's an executive and a leadership coach, and also a coach who believes in facilitating things which make a person very comfortable. I and Prashant had a one-to-one coaching intervention where we were doing our coaching journey. And at that time, what struck in my mind was one single Hindi sentence, "Bande mein dam hai yaar." You know, that kind of coaching conversation that I had with Prashant. He is a recipient of top 100 marketing influencer in 2016, which is recognized by the World Marketing Congress. That's another, feather in his cap as far as Prashant is concerned. He's a member of the Leaders Excellence at Harvard Square and also a global leadership assessor. He's a valued speaker and moderator at various national international forums and management. Prashant, we can't see you anymore.
I'm there.
Oh, okay, good. Okay. So that's how Prashant is. And with respect to, as I said, other than the health industry, he's a great coach. He's almost has 2,500 hours of coaching. And today Prashant is a speaker, and he would be speaking on a topic which is like make feedback count. When I think of feedback, and I go back around say 25 years when I used to receive feedbacks, I always used to get scared, and always used to go that again the boss will tell me something which I haven't done. And so 5-7 years early in my career, I always went there with a closed mind. And later on, I realized that if I had actioned on all those things which were told to me, maybe I would have been a better version of myself. And later in the career, when I was giving feedback to my people, that thing continued to strike me. And I always found it a little difficult to balance the feedback. I was always thinking, if I say something, there's an area of improvement, will I be antagonizing? So my feedbacks normally would be, 80% all good things about the person and only 20% maybe something that the person needs to improve. So that is how I struggled while giving feedback. So that way, I think today's session is going to be extremely, extremely exciting for me. And I think it would be exciting for people as well who are in their careers, either receiving feedback or they want to give feedback. So all yours, Prashant. Look forward to an interactive session and a very exciting one. So I'll stop share from my side, and you can then take over. Thank you all. Thank you, Prashant.
Thank you. Thank you, Vimal. And, I guess it'll be a pleasure to take you along places where I speak, because you just seem to make me look a lot more better than what I am. So if you don't mind, I will certainly clone you and take you around, because I never knew technical guys can be so savvy. Okay, we generally see you on the shop floor handling operations for large giants that you work for. And I guess you just make people look good. And that's a very positive feedback to you, Vimal. Staying on the topic. So thank you so much for your warm words. And thanks everyone for taking off the time. Today's Gandhi Jayanti, and I know how much it means to all of us to celebrate the holidays, though it falls on a weekend. But thanks for taking the time, and I hope to make it worth the while. I would like to narrate a couple of instances before I get on to the context of feedback. There are two cases. One is a female employee who joins a company, very, very fresh out of the graduate school, and got in as an assistant manager, works very hard. I mean, you know, does all the job that is needed, and you know, probably tries to help around a few colleagues because she's very new into the system, and keeps working hard. You know, tries and maintains a good relationship with the team, being a newcomer in the organization. And at the end of the first year, post an appraisal, she gets a rating of 3, that is, meets expectations. And she was a little pleasantly surprised that there's been no basic conversation on why that 3 came up. But she took it. The first year on the job, she took it. Next year, she works more harder. She says, probably my efforts were not well seen. They need to be really perceived very well by people. So let me give it all. And she started volunteering for a lot of projects. She started working and connecting with people, cross-functional groups, was really, really the talk of the organization for quite some time. And comes the appraisal back again at the end of the year, and she again gets a 3. Again meets expectations. And this time she's devastated. This time she's really devastated, and she says, there's no point. I mean, I've been slogging myself for the last 1 year, and I've really made my intent very clear that I'm really looking at being recognized better, I think favored better, or even, you know, given a better, you know, appraisal, but it all didn't seem to count. And finally, the third year, she says, now let me just not give a heck to all this extra things that I put in. Let me just go work in my own time, go to work, come back from work, just stay focused on the work. If any cross-function comes to me, I extend help, but I'm not going to go ahead and help. And again comes the famous appraisal at the end of the year. And I want to ask the audience, what you think in the chat box would be the rating that she would have got this time? From a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, and a 5. 5 being exceeds expectations, and is a fantastic people. So I just want to see what it is. Okay, there's a 2 that comes in. Okay, 7, okay. Okay, someone is having new breakthrough appraisal systems. 4, 2s, okay. So we have a flavor. We have a flavor from 2s and 8s and 4s, the highest rating. And not surprisingly, she gets a 3 again. She gets again a meets expectation. And she actually feels a smack on her face that this entire appraisal system was always a farce. Whether you put in your effort or you don't put in your effort, what's been decided to be given to you has actually come through. And I'm quite sure that quite a few of us in the group or would have known people similar to us who would have probably faced an appraisal like this. And not very surprising, come year 4, she starts looking out and she starts getting into another organization. And probably one doesn't know what the track is after that. But yes, that 3 consecutive appraisals, that 3 consecutive non-conversations led to the loss of probably a great employee that the company could have had. Let's go to another scenario. That's a very personal scenario. I am moved into a new department, into a new division, launching of a new company. And I work hard, have a new boss, things go fine. First year, excitement. Next year, the boss changes. I continue to work hard. A lot of new division, a lot of challenges. Division is taking time to perform. And obviously, I'm doing my job. And I was an individual contributor in the year 1. Year 2, I become a manager. I have a team under me. And we again have the same kind of a run there. And I am excited. I'm excited. And as it comes to the end of the year, my manager again quits. And I have a new boss who just comes on board. So 2 years go by. I don't get the kind of recognition that I think I deserved, and come to year 3. And I have a lot of mixed emotions about this. And I again continue to work a little more cautiously, but not as wholeheartedly as I did in the second year of that launch of the division. And the third boss comes in, and somewhere as the year ends, I again pick up my steam and keep working hard. And come the appraisal time, I again have given a meets expectation, but no elevation. No recognition, no correction. And this time I'm absolutely disgruntled, and I go back to my boss and ask him, what happened? why am I not being considered for a better recognition than what I got? And he says, well, I have just come on board. It's just a year since I've seen you. And I have to see you for at least 2 years to really make it count. And I say what's my fault? If my managers start leaving, what's my fault? What does the organization do? And then he says, well, you are asking this question a little late to me. Why didn't you ask the same question probably a year before or even a year before that? And that actually gave me another realization that feedback is not necessarily given. Feedback can also be asked. You've got to even ask what you got to do. And that's where you have a complete difference in both the case scenarios. One, a live case that was established in one of the famous publications about a case study on why feedbacks count. The second is a personal experience. And in both the cases, I walk away with a feeling that in one case, the feedback was far and seldom. In the second case, the feedback was never there, but even the feedback was never sought by me. Was that the way to approach? And in today's scenario, certainly that's not the way to approach. So as I set my context on making feedback count for all of us in terms of what it takes to give a feedback, what it takes to receive a feedback, what's two most important aspects here is what's the intention that you have? What's the intention that you have and what's the impact that you would like to leave with after a feedback is taken? That is something that's there. And while I've read, and I really believe that feedback sits on two core competencies. It sits on two core methodologies. The first is one needs to get better. The first premise that feedback generally believes in is that one needs to get better. That's why a feedback is given. The second is that one needs to be accepted the way one is currently. These are the two basic premises or human needs that a feedback generally revolves around. And it'll be interesting to see how many times we keep that in mind when we either give or take one. Come to this famous statement that Bill Gates said that we all need people who will give us the feedback. And that's how we improve. Because if you don't get feedback, it's a status quo. And you don't start seeing things that are going to be any different when a status quo happens. And what are we going to do today over the next 25 minutes is actually look at the three buckets of our conversation. It's going to be about what strategies are important to have constructive feedbacks, meaningful feedbacks. What strategies are required to look at what happens when you receive feedbacks? Solicited, unsolicited, what's the kind of feedback that I would generally like to receive and how would I like to imbibe those feedbacks? And the third and most important aspect that I have personally seen impacting many, many of them is on an action plan. What is the developmental plan that can translate this feedback into action? And there lies the success of a feedback. Because technically, feedback is like a gift. Once you give a feedback, you don't actually get to decide what happens to that feedback. It's a one-way traffic. Once I give a feedback, it's not in your hands anymore. So it is all left on the receiver to actually make do with what it is all about. And hence, the construct of the feedback, the intent of the feedback has to be in a manner that actually induces an excitement or an engagement from the receiver to act on that feedback. And that's when progress happens. That's when correction happens, or that's when even a continuum happens. Whatever be the intent of the feedback, that checkbox gets ticked. So let's look at some very, very important statistics, which I thought was relevant to the conversation today. The frequency matters. Why is feedback so important? The bottom line is that the frequency matters. And look at this data from Gallup. Not a very old data. This is a data that's less than 10 months old. 47% of employees report receiving feedbacks from their managers a few times a year, right? Or less, which is a very, very high percentile of people. Almost 50% of people don't receive feedbacks the way we want them to get. And let's say 19% of them actually say that feedback is got either once in a year or probably not even got. And what does this have an impact on? This has a direct impact on the engagement. It has a direct impact on the engagement. And there's this wonderful data that comes in the last 18 months when a lot of us have been more remote workers than in-office workers. The productivity of remote workers have gone up substantially when they've received feedback very frequently. And what is very frequently? From not receiving a feedback to receiving it once a year, when 19% of people spoke about it, 60 to 70% of people who received feedback as more than once a week have actually shown an increase in improvement of their engagement levels. And that's a startling. It's 4 to 5 times an increase of feedback that is given. And this tells you that it is sheer hard work. Giving a feedback is not a park walk. It is certainly a lot of destined, disciplined, and designed hard work. And once you do that, there's another data that talks about how a feedback on a consistent basis also improves the performance. So it's not only about the monetary benefits that one generally sees. Workplace recognition on the spot during the work times, when you start engaging people into great, meaningful conversations and give them the feedback, not only is productivity, but even loyalty seen to reach a much higher percentage. And that's what is the genesis and the intent of what feedback we would like to give. So how does a feedback look like? You have to look at the intent and the impact. The feedback should seldom be a seesaw effect, where you don't want an up and a down, you want a trampoline effect. You want that when a feedback is given, the amplification is a lot more positive. The amplification is a lot more impactful, that it is going to generate a high velocity and a high degree of consistency and impact on the job. And that's what it is. So make your feedbacks have a trampoline effect, because that is what will actually propel the person, the team, and the organization in a direction that you would like to look at. Keep your intent behind the feedbacks positive, because you would like to recognize and reward desirable behaviors. You would like to actually spot behaviors in people that need to explain and tell people to say that this instance is something that I love. I saw you managing that customer. It was a disgruntled customer. And I saw the way you handled it. Very calm, very composed. In a couple of minutes, the customer who was very, very agitated seemed to calm down. And that behavior was amazing. A positive feedback with an example given tends to make an impact. Or, you know, I love the positivity that you do. I love your customer handling impact. That's a great vague statement. Is that really going to make an impact? And what happens is, positive comments need to be preferably given even in presence of teams, because that starts influencing members all across. And that starts building a momentum that you would love feedbacks to be valued and appreciated and acted upon. Coaching, a great tool of feedbacks. The intent whenever is of coaching, feedbacks generally have had greater productivity and greater engagement rates. As a coach, I see it a lot more often. We keep using this style in our sessions. But as a manager, as a leader, if you start focusing more on coaching as a pattern or an intent to feedback, you'll start getting a greater commitment from the employees. Be careful on not pushing the feedback, or be careful of not giving the constructive feedback too much, because I'll come in a while to what it can actually start happening. Negative feedbacks, is it to be given? Definitely yes. Negative feedbacks, as we know, choose, while we say reprimand in private, but praise in public. And that's what negative feedback can be done. Please remember to cite instances of what is the negative feedback that you have observed in the person. And it's sometimes less the action, first the behavior. And if you can start spotting those behaviors, like we very typically do in a competency-based work, that's where you want to get that behavior moved up. You need to give negative feedbacks. Purely the intent is to stop incorrect practices that could be illegal or undesirable by a team member. And that certainly sends a lot of signal to people across. And I really like this concept about how there's been a very, very pragmatic and a consistent shift in the delivery mechanism of feedbacks. If you look at our feedbacks during our times, most often feedbacks were reactive. Most often feedbacks are reactive even today. But feedbacks is what we would love to call, in the medical term, it's like a postmortem. It's done, it's dusted, and you're just raising it from the dead and saying that this is what I observed or this is what you did. It pays to start changing the color or the contour of a feedback to a feed forward. And so beautifully enshrined in the Marshall Goldsmith's coaching methodology, the feed forward is a fabulous concept on how you can reinforce the method and the action, and the behavior is looked at a lot more actively. And this is a coaching methodology that each one of you leader can actually start playing it within your teams or within your colleagues. You don't need to be a leader to practice feed forward. It can be to anyone. And let me narrate this kind of an instance. You know, there was a time when there was a leader who was said that you're very temperamental. in meetings, you begin to flare up so effectively. So you please be in control of your temper whenever there are meetings that go on. Not everything in the meeting is going to give you a positive feel. So you don't need to react. He says, okay, feedback taken. Next meeting happens, again, the same message, again, the flare ups. What happens again after that? Again, there's a feedback that happens after the meeting is over. I told you the last time that you need to be a lot more managing your tempers, but you again went ballistic. What happens? And then don in your coach's hat. Be a partner to his success. What can we do as a feedforward mechanism? Let me give you insights on when I start noticing your temper going haywire. I will give you a flag. I will signal to you a color-coded flashcard that will tell you that, hey, you are probably jumping the gun here. Calm down, slow down. And that flagging the person during the process is what is typically a feedforward mechanism. You tell the person, raise that instance to me when you start spotting it, because that's when I will start improving on the job, on the action a lot more faster. Hence, a very powerful flagging mechanism in a feedforward concept of a feedback actually starts working wonders. So try and blend your feedback with feed forwards, and you will see the journey only moving ahead. And very soon the leader who was temperamental probably didn't take him more than 5 to 6 meetings to be a lot more calmer, a lot more passionate. And yes, he certainly didn't need the flashcard prompt to actually tell him that he was going off balance in terms of the temper management. The performance review management. A lot of times there's a shift in the delivery mechanism in terms of performance reviews. Generally, if you look at what happens very typically in performance review systems is you tend to what we call a concept called as a feedback or a protective hesitation. You want to give bad news in a performance review. You sometimes tend to be as blunt and as curt as you want, but sometimes there is a hesitation that if I say something very critical, it might not be taken in the right spirit. And very often this is tended to be seen in often sometimes in a gender bias. When you start seeing a different gender bias, when somebody is noticed as being aggressive, you tend to want to be critical, but you get into a protective hesitation mold that you don't tend to give the feedback. You tend to sugarcoat your feedback. And when you start sugarcoating feedback, it's not going to start helping you. So what we actually call, it's like sandwiching the feedback, and that's not going to help you. You start good. You give some curt message in the between and end it up with something good. That's what we call a sandwich feedback. You think it looks good? Probably the answer is never yes. Because people will remember what's there in the center that was offered to them and not the first and the last. So when you eat a sandwich, when you eat a chicken sandwich, you remember that it's a chicken that's inside and not the bread. A hamburger has ham inside. So what's important in a sandwich feedback is never try and mix a sandwich feedback with a good comment in the front or the back. Give it as it is and never mix the coaching in between there. You might want to leave a message and say that this is the review, this is the evaluation that is done, because the evaluation always overweighs anything else. People remember the ranks. People remember that I got a 3, meet expectation and nothing else. Get that coaching conversation later. Get the coaching conversation that this is what I observed. We will meet another day very shortly to discuss on how do we look at moving forward. And that's where the blend of the feed forward and the coaching conversation starts working wonderful for a manager. What's happening? Episodic, formal, one-way monologues. We saw the Gallup study. It doesn't work. Frequent, continuous, casual conversations start making a bigger impact in the feedback mechanics. And that's what is a great shift in the delivery system of feedbacks that we're seeing in today's world. And that needs to be only accelerated as we move ahead. We tend to get very, very biased against criticism. When we get criticism, when we get critical feedbacks, the first impression could be, oh, I don't want to hear it. There is a bias that generally comes with me that I don't want to really agree to what has been spoken. I don't want to face it. The person who's telling me, the messenger, is somebody that I don't like. And when I don't like, it's the individual bias that comes into the person. It's a very conscious bias that comes in. I don't like the gentleman. So the source bias plays a big role here. Often it could be a mindset issue that I am generally very defensive. I tend to get very defensive. So what do I do? I feel very threatened. I don't want to really talk. So I play a victim card. And hence, a lot of times, it pays a lot of effort to prepare when you want to give a critic feedback. when you want to play a critical feedback, it really makes a difference in the way you deliver that whole critical feedback. And that's where the strategies that we talk about in the later slides is going to give you some insights that you really have with you. So the seven strategies that we really look at, the feedbacks, you know, is going to be, you know, preceded with this wonderful statement from one of the executive coaches to Steve Jobs and Roger, which is John Metton and quite big in his circuit, that if you reject feedback, you also reject the choice of acting in a way that may bring you abundant success. When a feedback is given, what's the harm in trying what happens to feedback? You never know what happens after that. And that's where the developmental plan that we spoke in the beginning actually starts happening. So think twice before you reject the feedback, whatever be the bias. Is it a source bias? Is it a confirmation bias? Is it a mindset bias? Please be sure on what could be the logic that you apply when you want to look at the whole part. So let's look very quickly at what the strategies are. And as I run through the slides, you might relate to it a lot more stronger, because these are things that you may be doing it, but are we doing it as regularly as we can? The first and the foremost apex reason is to build trust. There is no feedback mechanism that works without a trust factor. Whenever you're giving a feedback, people will always accept feedback once they trust the source, once they trust the messenger. If they trust the messenger, a lot of times you will then trust what is being said. So while we say, pay attention to what is said and not the person who's giving it to you, well said, difficult to practice. We always have that bias that hits against us very, very strongly. So how do we really work that out? It is important to build that trust factor. And let's assume you are a new entrant into an organization. There is a possibility that you don't have the trust factor there. Start observing. Start offering observations. Do not start giving feedbacks right away. Start giving observations, because giving an observation is a lot different than giving a feedback. A feedback is probably a lot more assumed, or you are trying to give a narrative to the person. So start offering observations. Build that bond of trust, especially for people who are new into an environment. It is important to do that. And once you build the trust, you always start learning to accept feedback much better. So as a giver, if I know that I trust, there is a relationship of trust between the two, it's a lot more easy. Difficult conversations are beautifully managed. When does conversation start getting difficult? It starts getting difficult when, one, when the frequency is not there. Two, when the trust is not built. Three, when you don't address issues directly and spot on, conversations start getting difficult. Conversation starts getting messy. Feedback start getting very critically felt. And that's where the trust factor starts coming in the first and the foremost. So people, when they receive feedback, are also very honest enough, if there's a trust factor, to give back an inclusive comment. And that's what starts not a monologue, but a two-way kind of a conversation. And this is something that's extremely important for all of us. Anytime that you would like to practice feedbacks or feed forwards, this starts working, the blended starts working a lot more effectively. It's all about timing it right. When do I give the feedback? While we know that reprimand in private, praise in the public, it's very difficult to time it. We tend to sometimes use authority in these points of time to actually give a feedback there and then. Well, you might say that the feedback is to you, but the message is to all. It might sometimes or most likely not work in your favor. You try and create an environment of threat when you start doing it. So what's important is make time for that frequent check-ins. Be consistent in the way you talk to people. Make your notes. Look at how a lot of people who are coaches, true blue coaches, observe their players in sports. They start making notes right throughout the entire game period. And when that is over, then there is a complete debrief and there's a complete discussion that happens on it. So as a manager, play the hat of that coach. Wear the coach's hat, where you start observing in a meeting as well, in a conversation as well. Don't react. Make your notes. Make your notes. Even when there is a feedback, a formal appraisal going on, when there is a reaction that might happen from the other side, keep making notes. Keep making notes and then start giving it back, because that is what actually starts helping. That's what actually starts helping. And when you receive feedbacks, solicit feedback at regular intervals. That mistake that I did, I certainly haven't repeated that again. I tend to ask feedbacks. And what's important is, generally, don't say, do you have any feedback for me? Most often than not, you tend to get the right answer. You tend to get the right feedback. You tend to get a more favorable feedback. And that's not what you want. That's not what will necessarily allow you to do better. What's important is, what's it in my behavior that you would like me to continue? What's in it in my behavior that you would like me to stop? So the start, stop, continue model is a lot more effective when you want to start soliciting feedback. And as they say, certainly solicit feedback from people who are difficult to manage. Certainly solicit feedback from bosses who are tough, because they will give you the edges that will help you sharpen yourself better. Because that's where. And do not go to them back again with the question, do you have any feedback for me? No. The whole question is, what do you think I can do to make our relationship look better? What is it that I can do to get the job done better? Or I would like to do this and I would like your support on this. That's how it starts working a lot better. So timing it is going to be very critical. Make your observations and offer your feedbacks or your comments a lot more in an appropriate manner, because the entire buy-in is a lot more stronger and effective. There's an aspect of the message. Like we said, the sandwich feedbacking generally doesn't look too good. Ensure that your message is very clear. A lot of times, what we say, the concept of unpacking the feedback, don't give vague comments. Oh, you know, you need to develop a positive mindset. You need to develop a positive mindset, and I don't see you very participative in meetings. So open up more. This is what we sometimes hear. In a meeting, you come back from it, open up more, be more aggressive, be more assertive. Now, that's not a clear message. The intent is that you want the person to be heard. And if you want the person to be heard, you need to give him an example. So there is an attribute of being positive in a meeting. Give him an example. Give him an example that, okay, you did something like this that certainly did not show, that behavior was not positive. That behavior was not constructive or was not aligned to the team's objective. And I would like you to work on that aspect. Now, what happens is the receiver gets a very clear message. The receiver gets a message that has got the right example of the behavior demonstrated by the person. And that is important. Let's assume you're a receiver where you're open to a very vague comment that comes in. Step up and ask questions. Be very specific on what exactly did you mean by this. You might even go ahead and ask, when did you last see me do something like this that I can certainly not repeat in the future? Please don't assume or jump to conclusions when something is told to you. No, you are not good at this. Please tell me, how does looking good feel to you, or make it appear? That's an extremely important aspect in messaging that you need to really deliver as a whole part. Rehearse your delivery. I mean, there's another instance that I had in one of my roles. I was really talking to a senior guy and I had a midterm appraisal with him. And there was a gentleman who was senior in the organization by designation. He was one of the senior team leaders and he had a great authority. But I landed up in a review with him and I realized that I was not even prepared. I realized that I didn't have any points that was made which I could actually narrate and make him understand what is the reason that I'm coming from. Where's the term that I'm coming from? And it landed up in such a bad experience that the whole message was not delivered right and the whole intent went completely wrong. And what happened is I had burnt my bridges with him. It took time for me to rebuild it and I have wasted a lot of productive time of the organization as well as my relationship with him. So what's important is at all points of time, please rehearse your deliveries. We generally tend to do that whenever there is a tough situation. Whenever there is a conflict-driven situation, we might even sometimes not be as prepared for annual appraisals or midterm appraisals. So the practice of rehearsing your delivery is very, very critical. What are the points that I'm going to tell him? What are the areas that I'm going to speak to him about? It's extremely important. Make your notes. Making your notes and staying ahead is going to be important, because as you make your notes, very typically important when you're giving something that's critical. When you're giving something that's critical, it's extremely important. The tone matters. The tone matters on how you want to really put across your point to the gentleman in the front. Because anything that sounds not what you intend is going to be reflected the way he's going to take it. So in terms of constructive feedback, there's this wonderful thing that we heard Marshall Goldsmith talking about, is that there's an idea that the guy has given and I want to give a feedback to him. And as a manager, I love to add value. So I add value, I add more value, so much so that the engagement and the commitment to deliver that starts going down by 50%. I must have added only 5% value to the entire conversation, but the intent and the commitment of the doer has dropped by 50% because he suddenly feels this is no longer my idea, because my idea has been sabotaged. So constructive feedback can sometimes tend. You might think you're giving a constructive feedback, but there's very little value addition. So refrain from such type of constructive feedbacks. Please gauge what exactly is it. And hence, rehearsing the delivery becomes a lot more impactful. When you are on the receiving end and you are getting a unprepared communication from your leader or from a communication colleague or anybody, do not interrupt. Please, you might also make do with your notes, what has been said, because it's important to play back. It's important to play back purely to get more clarification. So ask clarifying questions. If the delivery is not appropriate, ask clarifying questions. Ask what is it that he intends to see in the behavior that would make him believe that there is change that's happening post a feedback. That's important. So listen to the entire feedback in entirety and then start your, like your, you know, check back on the entire process. Another strategy that we talk about is to be positive. It always plays to be positive at all points of time. And that's where we said the coach starts working. So there are broadly three kinds of, you know, feedbacks that are given. One very typically is an appreciation feedback. Generally, you feel good, good, well done, good job done. The second is a coaching kind of a feedback where there is a genuine intent to get the person better on the job. And the third one is more of an evaluative feedback. That's more on the ranking. You see that generally during performance appraisal times. So what works the best in favor is always the coaching kind of a feedback. And that's where positivity starts becoming a very important perspective or a strategy in your feedback tools. So be a coach to your team. Give the entire focus on future improvements that can happen on the job. The feed forward mechanism works brilliantly here. So when you do that, you'll see the entire atmosphere being created as one that I walk out of that room, I walk out of that feedback conversation, and I'm going to be extremely energetic about getting it done. That is very critical for us. So when you receive feedback, whatever be the kind of intent, try and stay positive and note down. People might get accusatory, people might get critical, but try and find out for the behaviors that is upsetting the entire conversation or that's upsetting the team environment. Ask for those behaviors because it is your intent to do better and to grow. If that's your intent, then you must start carving out your ask back or you know, clarifying questions in a manner where there is a positive outcome that is ultimately going to be desired. And this could be a very, very tough one as you start navigating yourself in the feedbacks. Encourage dialogues. Encourage dialogues. There is no two thoughts about it. When you give feedbacks, it's never a one-way traffic. You always need to ask opinions. And when you start making people a participatory role in the entire conversation, you start getting a better buy-in. So you might suddenly, if you're underprepared, but if you're inclusive, you will come back with a better outcome. So being underprepared, but being participative is a wonderful style where the person starts conversing and starts adding on to the value of the whole conversation. That's where feedbacks can make a difference. And when you receive feedbacks from subordinates, when you receive feedbacks, generally feedbacks from top, we generally take it with a lot more seriousness. But when feedbacks come from down, please remember it takes great courage for your colleagues or your subordinates to give you feedback. Please be open to accepting the feedbacks. Understand their intent, understand what behaviors did they observe for them to comment in a manner like this. Because only when feedbacks becomes two-way, it becomes a transaction between two people, you'll start seeing the positive impact of it. And hence, at all points of time, encourage dialogues, whether it is downward or it is upward. Please start encouraging dialogues in the feedbacks. Make it a participatory conversation and not a unilateral conversation. And finally, the last strategy that we talk about is keep it in perspective. A lot of times, feedbacks can tend to be more people-driven. People, it can tend to be out of focus. And hence, it's very important as a feedback giver is to be staying within the framework or within the guardrails of what your feedback is all about. Especially when you look at negative feedback, generally, it is to talk about the behaviors that you observe and not to settle scores. So please make clear that this perspective is always kept in mind. Let's assume you don't get a perspective. Let's assume you're on the receiving end and you are just getting a barrage of suggestions. Start listing down. And at the end of the whole conversation, you might want to ask that there have been 7 areas of improvement that I've spoken. Do we need to look at the entire thing in its entirety and all our high priority? Help me prioritize. What would be the first action items that you think will make it effective for me? So if you don't get a perspective from the feedback giver, as a receiver, please look at asking for the perspective. Look at what are the quick wins that will help you bridge the issue and also strengthen a relationship with the people. Because at the end of the day, when you start getting feedbacks that are critical, that are not, or it is all over the place, you tend to remember positive feedbacks less. Because the next email comes, you're back into the square one and thinking back on why the perspective was not dealt rightly. So please remember on how this can start playing a role in the way you start looking at it. Action plans are very critical. And like this Dilbert, famous cartoons, whenever you have feedbacks, the whole essence of the feedback or the whole success of the feedback is when you actually start working out on an action plan. And finally, this is a wonderful note that came in from the HBR about why it is so critical to create a plan of action. Any feedback given, the choice of acting on the feedback is on the receiver. Even if you are a leader, the choice of acting on the feedback is the receiver. So create an environment where you thank your receiver of the feedback or the provider for the time and the comments and the observations that are given. Summarize what it is all about. It's a stepwise focus. Both the sides, the positive and the negative, things that you should start doing, things that you should stop doing, things that you should continue doing. Re-look, recheck, re-emphasize that. Because once you reiterate that, it becomes easy to actually start asking on what questions you should start focusing on. And don't be defensive. Clarify those questions. Go behind the behavior that will make you act that way. I have to become less temperamental. So cite those examples or ask for those examples and ask for support. It's important to ask for resources that will help you achieve the goal. And as you articulate, also list down what are your strengths that you would like to leverage. What are your weaknesses that you need to take care of? Because that's where that resources again starts coming into the play. And finally, as an action plan, it's important to identify a coach. Your manager could be a coach or a mentor, a colleague could be a mentor, or somebody very senior could be a mentor, because these are your hooks that will take you and give you that safety net to really start operating on. And that's what we would generally tend to keep as an action plan, because without an action plan, a feedback is as good as heard and forgotten. It will never start seeing it. And go back, check, keep it, calendarize it. A lot of people who take feedback seriously start calendarizing the action plans, that this is what I need to act on. And this is what I will go back and tell my feedback giver, that this is what I have made a progress. Did you notice any difference? And when you start doing that, the entire process of a feedback, a discussion, and an action plan start seeing a lot more, holistic view to start moving ahead. So average players, as Doc Rivers, a famous NBA star, a good player for the Spurs, and then became a basketball coach, talks about average players want to be left alone. They don't want to change the system. Good players want to be coached. Good players want to be coached because they want to get better. But the great players are the ones who want to be told the truth. Now you need to decide what kind of a player you would like to be. Would you like to be? And what kind of feedback and feed forward conversations you would like to either have with your colleagues or you would like to have with your manager? Ask or seek. And what is important is what we discussed today. The seven strategies very quickly in a nutshell is to build trust. The time is to be right whenever you say it. The tone is going to be extremely important. Focus on the message. What's the intent of giving this feedback? Is it to continue something, stop something? Focus on that intent. Rehearse your delivery. A lot of times we go unprepared and that leads into a very half-hearted feedback exercise or a mechanism. Stay positive. Be the coach, don the coach's hat, because that starts looking at alternatives that you can actually start building. And encourage your conversations. Keep the perspective right. Keep the messaging right. Because if you are staying within the perspective, there is every reason that the intent that you give the feedback will certainly land with a positive outcome. Thank you so much for your time and for this little glimpse on what feedbacks are as an impact and as an effect for all of us. Over to Vimal.
Thanks, Prashant. Very enthralling conversation. I was captivated actually all the time when you were speaking. So a lot of questions for you, Prashant.
Please go ahead.
The first question that comes is from a coach's hat is that please give an example of a performance review to a coaching conversation.
Well, I think it's important to first list down what are the prep steps that you would take. Typically, a good conversation is you know, all about keeping the frequency very active. Generally, when the frequency is kept, even today, midterm frequency of performance appraisals are outdated. It's all about monthly, and you saw the impact of the Gallup study that talks about weekly conversations start helping. Now, the weekly conversations are not performance appraisals. So what happens is, when you start increasing the weekly connect or the monthly connect with your colleagues, your performance appraisal starts getting a lot more productive and a lot more focus driven. So conversations that I have seen my great success with, I think, feedbacks that happens during that time is, one is, I think, set the context very right. Very often we don't set the expectations, what the expectations are that I have of you or your role. What's the kind of behaviors I want to start seeing in you? And what's the kind of action that will emerge out of this? When these three are tied in well, and you start having your observations during the period of appraisal, I've generally seen that the conversation goes in a far more constructive manner, a far more two-way process. And there is an action plan that emerges where the colleague walks away a lot more confident from what it is.
Thanks, Prashant. That clarifies a lot of things. I was when you were speaking, I was actually, you know, trying to correlate. You were mentioning a lot of ask versus tell, and that is how the coaching conversations also happen. So you were always mentioning how the manager can ask and how the receiver can ask various things. So I think that is also which came up during the conversation. Another question for you is, how would you view or on trying to obtain reverse feedback in the same session, which means?
That's a nice one. I mean, reverse feedback is something which is what you get from generally people. Reverse feedback should be focused on what kind of behaviors you would like people to see in yourself. I mean, very typically, if you go with a standard question of give me a feedback about yourself, you would not get that feedback. People will generally tend to give you good feedbacks. It's very rare that people will start giving you feedback the first time you walk up to someone and say, you know, what's your feedback about me and my work? And you'll tend to hear the right things. You'll tend to hear things, okay, you're good in this. The second time you go, and you will not get all the right things in the first instance. The second time you ask him the feedback, you'll get a couple of more, you know, reason. So as you increase the frequency of feedbacks, you will start getting more realistic into what your goods are and what your not goods are. And that's what happens. So if you want reverse feedback to start being effective, increase the frequency of asking people and start asking for behaviors that they observe, or what is it that you would like me to work on? What is it that you think I'm not doing right, which I should stop tomorrow? And I've seen this. I mean, normally in my assignments, as you know, heading organizations, I've tended to ask some set of 5-6 questions to people across various levels, not my direct reports, but including my skip levels. And trust me, when written feedbacks come, people are really put into a spot of bother, because a lot of times I've got comments that nobody has ever asked me a feedback about you or about yourself. And that starts the whole process of thinking and reflective thinking a lot more active. And that's what actually starts happening. So when you get into a reverse feedback mechanism, the reflective thinking starts becoming a lot more pronounced. And you can start getting some amazing responses, which will make you a better person, a better leader, or a better team player.
Okay. Next question for you is, Prashant, how to give feedback effectively to a non-responsive receiver?
How would the feedback be effective to?
How can you give feedback effectively to a non-responsive receiver?
Well, probably then, I guess it starts with building more trust first. I think you've got to first start getting the trust quotient a lot higher. A lot of times when you give a feedback, there are many a times when you generally don't tend to play back what has been spoken. You know, and when you start playing back, saying that this is what we spoke, can you tell me, you know, typically what happens in a coaching conversation, you start asking for what are the action items that you've listed down. You start asking for a feedback on what have you listed down in our conversation today. And let's assume the person has said 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe you have also written down, if you've gone prepared, you've already written down what is there as a part of the conversation. You also then play that back, saying that these are a few more things that we discussed. Are you in agreement to it or no? When you start binding in a conversation and a response back, a lot of times the non-responsive responder also starts beginning to fall in line and begin to buck the trend. And you might make some headway as you start progressing it on a regular basis. So in such cases, what is also a good mantra is start having more frequent conversations with the person. If you are going to have a calendarized event at all points of time, may not always work. You need to pepper that in between with certain informal meetings, certain coffee cup meetings, certain water cooler meetings, anything. Just feel free and have a chat on something. Build that kind of a communication where the non-responder starts believing in what you have as a messenger.
Nice. This is coming from a seasoned coach. How to, in a coaching conversation, how to make people respond. Great one, Prashant. The other one which comes in is, what should one do when the feedback goes wrong? I mean, what is the recovery path in that case?
The recovery path from where? Is it on the receiver side?
The feedback goes wrong. I mean, during the conversation, it goes in a very different trajectory. It goes wrong.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think that quite often happens, especially when the viewpoints don't meet, when there is no acceptance to a certain thing. So I guess here there's a lot of responsibility on the senior of that conversation, that, you know, whoever is the senior in that conversation, the responsibility lies on the senior is to really, you know, relook at another meeting purely with an intention of knowing somebody better. You know, you need to have these kind of off the cuff meetings. I mean, don't really make it a formal setup. Try and understand the person a lot more. Try and build a bridge between the two before you even go back to either clarify what happened that day, or even if you go back to start a new conversation on a feedback mode. I think refrain from that. I think what's important is try to mend the bridge, try to mend the relationship, understand each other. Maybe a lot of times an open conversation without an agenda always tends to soothe tempers and, you know, build some relationships.
Okay. The other question is about your sandwich approach, Prashant. Somebody says that, you know, somewhere in a very reputed management class, we have been taught to follow sandwich method to give feedback. Till now, followed that. Now, should I change that now onwards?
Well, certainly, yes. Certainly, yes. I mean, you know, if you try and say something nice before saying something nasty, it doesn't work. Where is the impact? The impact is, one, on your sincerity of the entire conversation. The impact is on your credibility. The impact is on what's the actual purpose of the feedback. If you are trying to sugarcoat, right, it is better to be straight. And if you want to really have a coaching conversation after that, schedule it something, because it's important to separate the three things. People will always remember evaluations more than appreciations, because at the end of the day, it's the number, it's the negative feedback that counts. So if you think that a sandwich approach is going to be the best way forward, I think that's going to come at the cost of a credibility, because the next time you say something nice, the guy is not sure what's the next comment that you're going to give. Is it going to be a jolt in the blue, or is it going to be a continuation of a conversation that is looking pleasant? So it's not a very great, it's not a very healthy and a very open-hearted conversation to sandwich things in between.
Okay. And the other question is, how does one stay positive if one's actions have been criticized in the feedback session?
I think there's a lot of coaching that comes in here. What is important is to understand the reasons behind those actions. You know, if an action is criticized, let's just go to the triggers that happen. What are the triggers that lead him to take that action? What could be the preventive mechanics that can stop him from those triggers from emerging the next time? Because if you start helping him to unwind and unopen certain things that are a bother that leads him to create that actions which are being criticized, it might do a world of good to the receiver. Is that, yes, that's where the coaching starts helping, because you tend to work on the root cause and not just the superficial action that is generally seen on the face of it all. So work back, look at the triggers that come in and address those triggers, so that those actions that come up, which are critical, will be seldom and probably later on nil.
Prashant, a lot of questions. So maybe we'll have to extend this session by another 5 minutes if people are okay.
I'm okay. Not a problem.
Okay. So one great question is, who is responsible to track actions arising out of feedback? It's the provider or the receiver?
You know, this is surely coming in from someone where accountability is not of concern. Okay. So certainly first and foremost is the receiver. first and foremost is the receiver. And I would also go to say that if there is an action plan that is said during a feedback session, suppose there's an action plan that is said, okay, I'm going to be working on my, let's say, working on my team management skills. So what am I going to do? I'm going to be a part of more teams. I'm going to be giving you, okay. So the action plan is that whenever I'm a part of a team meeting, I will make some minutes and share it with you. If that's an action plan to tell you that I'm more engaged in a team meeting, and that is going to tell me that I'm getting a better team player. I'm trying to take up initiatives or take up responsibilities. So this is my action plan. And it's important for the giver, the feedback giver, to ask him, how often would you want me to discuss on this? So it's important to set the ground rules right in the beginning, because then that sets the boundaries for which the person is working on a plan. And even there's a checker who does the check, because that's what very typically you do as a leader or even as a coach. There is an action plan given by the coachee or by your reportee. But if you just leave your hand or your leg off the pedal, you might be in for a rude shock. And that's what happens when you talk once in a year or once in 6 months, and you still don't see a change.
Okay, in today's world, when you know everything in business is about numbers, how do you quantify feedback?
How do you quantify? Well, feedback, all evaluation feedbacks are quantifiable. The feedback that is based on evaluation is a very strictly by numbers. I mean, you're managing by numbers. But any feedback that's appreciative, you might even appreciate good numbers. But anything that's a coaching conversation feedback, those are all behavioral feedbacks. So if you look at the three forms of feedback, the appreciative, the coaching, and the evaluation, the number feedbacks are all evaluation feedbacks. That's very typically in a performance appraisal or in a business meeting, you see some number and you give it. What's important is to understand the actions behind achieving those numbers. You know, are those actions continuable? Are those actions probably going to fall off at some point of time? You know, can they lead to another complication? So you really need to check that.
This is a very interesting question which has come up. Should feedback giver also share the consequences to the receiver if not improved in committed time?
Ideally, those are very different kinds of appraisals that happen. I mean, those are very typically maybe a performance improvement appraisal, where you generally have a very different yardstick to measure the entire conversation. So that's less a feedback and that's more an evaluation process that happens. So a feedback generally tends to be positive. A feedback generally tends to be constructive. A feedback generally tends to be an enabler. But if you're really talking about, if you don't do this, this is what is going to happen, you don't call that a feedback. I mean, you call that an ultimatum in terms of something not being done. So that's more a review. That's more a review.
Okay. Another question which comes up is that during feedback session, what happens is many managers, they try to tell the subordinate, this is how it has to be done, which means their own preferences are being told to the subordinate that this is how you should do or this is what you should have done. How do you, you know, as a giver as well as a receiver, handle this kind of a situation?
Well, one of the strategies of effective feedback is to be making it two-way. If you really want feedbacks to be up and forth, you really need to make it inclusive. So a lot of times, you know, if your prep levels are anywhere average to weak, you will come across a situation where somebody, where you're giving a feedback to a smart guy, will always come back and say, I think there's a better way to do this. And as a mature leader, you need to really be, or as a progressive leader, you need to be really inclusive of what his ideas are. You need to take that reverse feedback and actually make it a part of the plan. You're right. I mean, you've got a third element that can be added into the whole conversation. So make it two-way, make it inclusive, make it participative. That's where brainstorming happens. So what happens is, very typically, if you look at feedbacks, you've got a minor issue, you've got a major issue. If there's a minor issue, the leader is or the person whom you're giving the feedback is aware of it, ask him questions on how he would like to resolve it. If it's a minor issue, not creating an issue, not really damaging anything, and the person is not aware of that issue, ignore it. Don't really spend time on it. Let's look at another scenario where it's a major issue. When it's a major issue, if the person is aware, ask questions and brainstorm with the person. Brainstorm and come up with action plans that can be achieved together. The second part is, if he's not aware, then there is a very typical thing is, wear your coaching hat. tell him what your expectations are, what are the examples that you would like him to be demonstrating, and then what is the whole empowerment that you can give him. So that's the kind of strategy that you might attempt with a minor issue and with a major issue during a feedback conversation.
Wonderfully explained, Prashant. I'm afraid there are still few more questions which are to be answered, but I would be forced to stop here, and I would request our guests to either email us.
I can take that. Anjini has raised her hand.
So, yeah, Anjini, you've raised your hand. No,
I just clapped.
Oh, that's good. Oh, sorry. I missed that one. Great work, Prashant. So we stop here. And we thank all our participants for having such an engaging session. And just as a parting thought, you know, in case you have any query that you might want us to answer, or you want to get in touch with us, I would request you to, you know, get in touch with us here, and we would be, you know, more than happy to take your queries. We will answer them to the extent possible. And whoever wants to have a coaching session, you know, scheduled for us, we can be contacted at these numbers and these addresses. So thank you very much. Have a nice evening, and Shabbat Khair. Good night.